welcome to these charming fans. My name is Colin Manford, and joining me in the studio today, Mick Cullen and Natalie Pike.
Hi.
Just one hi, you did a nice wave there, Natalie. That's lovely. I should say super fan, Natalie Pike.
I don't know if I like that tag.
All right, I'll keep it to fan zone. Danny Jackson, then, your friend. He is a super fan. He took that.
Did he?
He took that fan, yeah. Producer Steve will tell you all about this. When we filmed the podcast with him, he was loving it. So
yeah,
you're only second place now then. But what Danny will never have is the honour.
He'll never have height.
He'll never have height. He's a very small man. He's coming on in a couple of weeks.
You can tell him myself.
We'll play it back. Yeah. We'll get his reaction. Because, of course, he's very bitter because you're always one up on him.
Always.
Bring up the quiz.
Yeah.
The Derby quiz. I don't know if anyone saw that at home on the City website. Natalie levered him. Wasn't it? We brought that up in the podcast, actually.
Did you? What did he say about it?
He went, oh, you do that. with his little scally voice.
You sure he's going to come on as a guest after this?
It depends if he watches the other. Yeah. But I was saying, because you are our first official guest, because I asked you before I asked Mick. Mick was my driving instructor, which that's the only reason he's got on, really.
Yeah, I don't actually have a claim to be here, other than I feel up a sofa quite nice.
It's a lonely place, that car, which is one of yours. But I mean, as you see here, the mascot of the show is this duck.
Aww.
And we're going to name him
him.
Yeah, I'm going to call him Natalie.
Oh, that's so nice.
We've got Natalie the duck.
Oh,
Pike the duck, Pikey duck.
Pikey duck.
Pikey duck. Which one do you want?
Yeah, either.
Pikey, let's call it Pikey.
Oh, Pikey.
And then people have to watch the first show to understand it.
You can test them, you can say, what's the duck called?
Yeah.
Yes.
That's up to these shiny fans, what's the duck?
Mm-hmm.
It's not Pikey, you're out.
Yeah,
Pikey. So we're Pikey, it's Pikey the damn happy.
Thank you very much.
It's sad when you've got a duck with no name. I had a pound for every time I had a duck with no name. I'd have a pound. The first one.
So we've got Pike of a Duck and Grandma Colin.
All right, I'll explain the cup before we do crack on. I was going to try and get away the whole season without people knowing. I went to buy props. You look around, there's a lot of props for the set. I went to the City Store and I got a mug. I went, oh, it's going to be great. I can drink my tea. And I got excited and I cracked it open when I got to the studio and I didn't realise it said Grandma on the bottom of it, so I'm embracing it. One day, we all become grandmas, don't we? So that's time. We're all catching up with all of us. So I'm not making any sense here. Cheers for embarrassing me on my own show.
Yeah. Should we talk about City?
Yeah, we should do, really. So, Pikey.
Thought you'd be all right here.
Yeah, I'm the glue that holds this stuff together. So we are going to talk about City. We'll start the show with the review of the season so far. Very impressed, apart from the last couple of games in the Champions League and West Ham, but it's been really impressive. Top of the league, a lot of people were saying we'd win it by Christmas. we'll start from scratch. West Brom opening game of the season, 3-0. It was almost like a different team to last season. We kind of last season fell flat and we still finished strong, but it was too late, wasn't it?
It's been a bit of a rollercoaster season already, and we're only a few games into it. Pre-season obviously was pretty poor. A load of the pundits wrote us off before the season even started. Dion Dublin said we wouldn't even finish in the top four.
Well, funny you said that. Is it Savage on his newspaper column? He's wrote an apology recently.
Really?
And he said, you'll notice pre-season I had United finishing above City. Of course, I meant it the other way around. It was a printing error. So.
Yeah, there's plenty of printing errors that happened before the season starts, by the look of it. Loads of them, you know, there's only, the BBC looked at 28 pundits, and only two of them said that we'd win the league, and one of them was Ali Mann, who's a City fan.
Yeah.
So it was nuts. And then we started the season, the first game of the season, absolutely smashed it. All of a sudden, the roller coaster's getting up here. We sat on the top for a bit. And then at the weekend we started to come back down
again.
Yeah. No, not oblivion.
The oblivion ride, the roller coaster.
Yeah, we're not there yet.
But
no.
I don't think you're understanding what
I do. We're on a little dip right now. We're not on a plummet.
Yeah, but my point was staying up there for a while. There's no roller coaster that does that. Lost in translation here.
No, because you're saying we've plummeted.
I'm not saying we've plummeted. My example was we were up there.
And then what happens after that?
Yeah, it goes down, but then it shoots straight back up.
Yeah, but it plummets down.
And we've lost two in a row. Well, why are we arguing each other?
It's not oblivion.
This analogy is fabulous, guys. I'm glad I came.
It's more of like the mouse ride from Blackpool.
I want to go to a theme park now.
Should have a team day out.
Yeah.
Not all the time.
Yeah. it's cheap now though. Tickets are up, right?
Yeah, yeah. Okay, we're off topic again. It's not too soon either. then we all right. So Chelsea. So we continue to rise on this roller coaster that is Manchester City. That Chelsea game was stunning, though, Mick.
Yeah, of course it was. We, it was a game that potentially was too soon in the season for us. It was a game that we didn't want just yet, because leading up to the season, when them fixtures came out, and like you say, the poor pre-season, we didn't know what to expect, and playing Chelsea at that time was a big worry. Then after the West Brom game, obviously, we started to think, oh, actually, yeah, we're looking good here. And the Chelsea game, we just blew them away. They weren't in the game at all, bar maybe so 5 minutes in the second half.
I mean, beating a rival is one thing, but when that rival's manager is Jose Mourinho, does it not make it so much sweeter? Mourinho's when he first came to Chelsea all them years ago, it was funny. This arrogance was amazing, but I think now it's just, to call it a fake result, they got destroyed.
They got absolutely destroyed, and I think it summed up probably the best way of summing it up was reading their match report.
It was absolute myth, I thought it was a parody.
Do you when you go on Twitter and you're like mandatory facts and boring James Milner?
Yeah.
I thought this is definitely it's gotta be a parody.
I thought it was, and then you realise you're on Chelsea's website.
Doing their own match report. Well, speaking of our own match reports, I'll put this in quickly. We've got our very own match day reporter called Gail Cliches.
Wow.
And he did his first game was Chelsea, and that's coming up later on. We'll show you that. If he does well, he's gonna stay on for the full season.
Oh, I'm hopeful for him.
Yeah. He's on a pay and play at the moment.
he's getting paid.
Good. Well, you know, chocolate bars.
Yes, galaxies and sparkling water like all the guests. moving on, Everton, which is everyone knows in terms of bogey teams, they've really stuck it to us over the years. And again, I felt it was comfortable.
I hate going to Everton. Every year I go to Everton and I say I'm never coming to Everton again. Then every year I go, I think I've been away for the last 5 seasons to Everton. And I always hate it because I don't really like the ground. But this year, it was last year I said I'm never going again, season flat, I'm never going again. This year I'm going to go next year. it was good. Yeah, I'm happy this time. You know, like you say, one of our bogey teams, we've overcome it. Mm. With great, great, solid display.
I think as well, obviously the display against Chelsea was good. The display against Everton was phenomenal. Some of the play we were putting in, David Silva in particular, was just unbelievable. There was one where a simple drag back took three players out, and they're all just sliding past each other. It really showed up.
Talking
what we're capable of.
He is absolutely unplayable at the minute. And we do miss him, obviously. Mm-hmm. West Ham being a case in point there, but Silva, surely now he's in the same bracket. He should be named up there with Messi and Ronaldo. I know as a City fan, people might call us biased for that, but you see some of the stuff he's done this season. Literally when he's got to the byline and you've got three players around him, you go, well, get a corner. Mm. And he doesn't. He does some magic with his feet and he's in the penalty area. You're like,
that's why they call him Merlin, because it is magic, isn't it? What he does, you just don't expect it at all, and that's why he's so valuable to us.
Yeah, but he's been doing this for years now, and us as City fans have been lucky enough to watch him now for years and years.
Yeah.
But it seems to be only this season that other people are picking up on it. We've been saying that he's one of the best players in the world for years, but it's nice that eventually he's starting to get
that, that pass in the 6-1. If you make Dzeko look good, you're a good player. I know we shouldn't be mean. He's out on loan, isn't he? So we can say what we want about. We'll talk about players a bit later on because I've got some strong opinions on a couple.
You can't wait to get the steam coming out your ears to talk
I
about
am,
that.
Yeah, no. Unless we just do it now. It's phony. What is the point? Why is he here? He was good at Swansea.
He's really good at Swansea.
Yeah, really. He was a Premier League top scorer, wasn't he? He was for the calendar year. Yeah. He was the leading scorer for the
Still
Premier League.
Still playing against the same defences now, same Premier League defences.
So what's his
don't know.
Possibly that he's not the main man. At Swansea, he was the main man.
He was never going to be the main man. Though. When you've got Sergio Aguero, there's
he wasn't.
Very, very few players in the world that will be a main man ahead of him.
Yeah.
I feel a bit sorry for him. He came in January to big expectations from us. He was so good at Swansea and we fought quite hard to get him. And then he had some injuries. He didn't play too much. And we stuck by him and City fans, we really defended him. And then we came into this season thinking, maybe he'll start coming into his own. unfortunately for him, we started playing with a five in midfield and the one up front. But then when he's had his chances, he's just not taken them, and he's not taken them at all. And I feel like maybe he's coming to the point now where he's sort of grace period is coming to an end.
Oh yeah, patience is definitely January. Colin's case in point.
Patience Colin's face, yeah.
January, let's send him back to Swansea. Can go back on loan. Aww. And well, I don't know. Everyone around me at the game now as well. You know, people have switched and. Every year, someone falls victim to the Boo Boys, and I reckon Boney.
Do you think it's Boney or Navas?
Well, Navas is an interesting one. Navas, last season, if you would have asked me that, I hated him. Navas last season was my Boney from this season. Like, I just, oh God, he just frustrated me because you can see there's something there. But all he was doing was he would run to the byline and try and get a crossing. And it was so frustrating, he got found out. And yet he played pretty much every game under Pellegrini. Yeah. So he was seeing something that we wasn't. Mm. And this season, it's almost as if Pellegrini's kind of took him to one side and go, you've got to do something different. And I think it's worked, because Navas has been one of our better players this season. Yeah, he's cutting in a bit more, he's looking for the pass.
I think he's been a lot better this season, certainly. But my feeling with Navas is always is that he's on a very, very fine line between being incredible and being really, really bad. And he can have incredible moments where his pace is taking him past everybody, and he gets to the byline, he gets himself in a position, and he receives a difficult pull, and it sticks to his foot, and he's incredible, and you're like, wow. And then he crosses it, and you're like, for God's sake.
If he didn't look like Dynamo, you'd be gone. I say.
There is that nervousness about his play, isn't there? You know, he gets in the box and panics. He just, yeah. He just has
the players
nothing
around him. This is what I don't understand. Is I have these debates with brothers and stuff. Niall, we'll talk about Niall. Like, Niall's my little brother. He's the ultimate knobhead, because he's young fans are spoilt. I don't know if you guys agree with this. Young fans are so spoilt that if things aren't going right. So West Ham, we got beat. Like, might as well address that now. So we got beat. We didn't play terrible. We dominated possession. We had so many shots. You know, the corners and the crosses were coming in. Wasn't our day. West Ham, in my opinion, played anti-football. You know, they were constantly going down. They got the win. They played the tactics well, and they got the 3 points. But I had Niall down my ear going. You know, he was slagging Nasri off. Nasri was nowhere near. He was nowhere near the game. He was Nasri, and then he was like Pellegrini. He's a terrible manager. You know, and he's got plan A, no plan B. I was like, dude, we're top of the league still. You know what I mean? We're not gonna win 38 games.
It's people born this century. They don't really know, do they? They don't know. They missed 99, and then they were born in this century, so they're never really going to fully grasp it.
That's what it for me. That's why I'm so grateful now, because I was like, say in my household, you got my dad, who saw City when they were good, and then we were terrible for so many years, and now we're good again. Whereas for me, we were just rubbish.
Yeah.
And I got used to that. You know, we're Jerry Creaney. You know, Tim Bradbury was Tim Bradbury.
Tim Bradbury?
Lee Bradbury. Tim Bradbury's a comedian friend of mine. Well, no, like Lee Bradbury was a big
was
time,
a comedian,
wasn't
he? Wasn't he?
Yeah, he played like a comedian.
Yeah, yeah.
But do you know what I mean? We had that kind of thing of, like when Stuart Pearce was managing, we scored like 11 or 12 goals all season.
We didn't score from, was it New Year's Day or New Year's? From New Year's Day on. We didn't score at home for the rest of the season.
We played something I used
Those
to call...
Those were the days.
Yeah.
We used to play crab football, I used to call that, because it was just... You'd get to midfield, you have Reina to Bosvelt to Massampa, and let's knock it back here again. You're like, oh, God, we've got a striker, I'm sure. But that was... You know,
never slide Kiki Massampa. If you score at Old Trafford, then you're forever in my good books.
Kiki Massampa, yeah. That's the instant legend. Yeah. But no, do you know what I mean? So we were terrible, but we had a sense of humour with it. And so now that we had this takeover, which is stunning, by the way, we should really touch upon that how it all happened. You definitely couldn't write. I'm doing a cliche there, which is Gail's job, but you know, to have someone like Shinawatra buy a club with no money, you know, bring us in people like he did, and then just sell us to the Sheikh, and then it's a fairy tale, isn't it? And so when people go, oh, you bought the league, you throw him yourself. Did United not start that? United have broke the record for smashing the most transfer records. So why is it when the big one Chelsea stepped up, City step up, it's suddenly we're ruining football?
Every club that's ever won the Premier League's bought it. Look at Blackburn when they won it. They bought the league. Granted, it was for about 20p and a packet of peanuts, but everybody's bought the league in their own way. And if you've got the money, you're going to spend it.
Of course you are.
Our owners are incredible. They're just absolutely incredible. The amount of money they've invested in the club, in the training facilities, in the local community.
Well, there's a leisure centre, there's a school, and they've just signed a deal with the council, haven't they, to build houses.
Yeah.
Just absolutely sound incredible. Like
they're going anywhere soon. I love that. That's my favourite bit of an argument with a United fan. They go, yeah, but what about when he gets bored? He's not getting bored.
No. Yeah.
Yeah. And if he does, so what, we had a good ride.
Yeah, exactly. You know,
I'll see you at Stockport.
I quite like the second division.
Yeah, it was good fun. It was cheap.
Yeah.
Tranmere away. Awesome.
Bring Keegan back. That's some great attacking football, isn't it? So moving on, Watford was a great game. Palace was very tough. We'll brush past them ones because I want to quickly talk about the Champions League. What's the deal? We've got a team now with the signings that came in, the way we started in the Premier League. How far, do you know what? I know Juventus is always going to be a tough opening game, but the way we started, and the majority of the game, we put in a good shift there.
We dominated for 70 minutes and you were thinking, wow, you know, these are the Champions League runners up and we're dominating them. But the problem that we had was that we didn't take our chances when we had them, and we had real clinical chances, you know, in the first minute. And then when we were 1-0 up, we had another chance to take it to 2-0. You need to finish those chances in the Champions League. You need
Sterling.
To put them to bed.
I'm blaming you, Sterling.
You know, if you don't take your chances, then, you know, you're leaving it for Juventus to get one chance in the 70th minute and to put it away, and then to get another chance and to put it away.
They've got the experience, haven't they? The Champions League stalwart, so they're they only need two chances to put a game to bed.
They beat us by a great goal. Mm. They didn't tap the ball in, did they?
Our goal was pretty special, though, to be fair. It wasn't a foul. Company was just really enjoying.
I just winked at the camera. I didn't wink.
Good old Billy, he's taken that goal.
Yeah, he should do. I loved it when he ran off celebrating. I was like, hold on.
Yeah. Manaman is the commentator, though. Did you hear the commentary?
No.
What? Oh my God. I don't know. He's, maybe because he played for us, he's got that kind of syndrome of, if I play for the club, I better slag them off when I'm.
Oh, like Danny Mills.
Yeah.
That's Danny Mills.
There's so many people. We could have our own little segment here.
Yeah. Whinge. Let's whinge for a minute about people
Which
we don't like.
City fans, we like whinging. Come on.
Yeah. Well, it's true.
Let's stop basking in our success.
Well, even now, like we are one of the most dominant teams in world football, but we do as fans go, oh, Navas, we might get dominated. In our house, it's called the Sibierski player. Because you remember Sibierski? He wasn't amazing. I didn't think he was terrible, to be fair. But
he wasn't terrible, but you're right, he wasn't amazing.
Yeah, but our Stephen hated him, like, with a passion. He used to say some really nasty things about Sibierski. Like, stuff like that you can never repeat. So in our house now, each year, we appoint him like a Sibierski player. I know you shouldn't, Aww. But every year you kind of get that one player where you go, wow, why is he playing for City? Like, Garcia was probably everyone's. Sibierski at one point.
Garcia was always going to be because of who he replaced.
Yeah.
Never quite replaced him. I don't know Fernandinho now, though.
I love Fernandinho. Absolutely love him. Two seasons ago, he was up there with my player of the season. The league.
Remember when we signed him? We did, because we went to the City party, didn't we? That you was co-hosting.
And when
we signed him, and he came and did that interview about... You know, a lot of Brazilians come over and they bitch about the cold weather, but he came from the Ukraine, didn't he?
Yeah.
he was always cold.
Yeah.
Yeah, love him. Absolutely love Fernandinho. I think he's had a stormer this year. I think he's a big part of the reason why we've played so well this year.
Plays with a smile as well. That's what I like.
Yeah, he's such a nice man.
It's like, it's almost like the South American influence, because you look at like Aguero, he gets hacked down all the time, gets back up. He never complains to the referee. Mm. Silva has kind of taken it on. He gets hit every week. And he gives it back now, I've noticed that.
Yeah, he does.
He's turned into quite a tenacious player.
Yeah.
So that's it, it's tenacious, not dirty. That's the thing.
He's cute when he does it.
Yeah.
Aww, look at it. It's getting annoyed.
It's like a little six-year-old when he chases the bigger kids to get the ball. But, he's trying.
I love Silva, though, so much. Is it fair to say, then, he's up there now? Should he be nominated for a certain award?
Well...
I think you've got to wait and see how the season pans out, but if it carries on how he started, then yeah.
I think that Silva and Aguero would both get nominated for a certain award if we just had a decent run in the Champions League. I think that's what it's
going to
come down to.
Is that what it boils down to then, a good run in the Champions League?
Well, that's something me and you've discussed before, isn't it? The fact that until we get that good run in Europe, we're not going to get the recognition. Mm-hmm. Not a chance. Aguero will not get that recognition. And like you said about people are only just realising Silva, people are only calling Aguero world class this year. They've always commented on him. He's been our main man.
Aguero is... that moves us nicely onto the next segment, actually, because Aguero, for the last few seasons, has just been absolutely amazing, and he will now go down in history as the man who scored... I'm going to show it now. He scored the most important goal in City's history, it's fair to say. So what we're going to do is we're going to show the goal against QPR that won us the league. We can have a little chat through it. We'll do like a commentary over the footage. But then we'll have a little chat about...
Who's going to be Martin Tyler?
No one can ever eclipse that moment, can they? But we kind of, it'd be nice to know, because every City fan's got a story about where they were that day. Were they at the match? Were they with the friends? You know, how did you celebrate afterwards? So let's have a quick look. Balotelli made him. Aguero. A goosebump moment, though, isn't it? Every time definitely. I see this, I get goosebumps.
And Aguero got a good foot on him there from Manua as well, didn't he? He could have gone down.
Was that Manua, do you reckon, trying to give us a penalty, though?
Maybe.
This is a lovely moment, I think. Yeah. Seems lonely back there, isn't it, Clichy and Joe Hart?
Someone goes, oh, celebrate with Joe!
Yeah.
He's running around like a madman. Yeah. So someone help him. But what a great moment.
I've just got all goosebumps.
The goosebumps all
yeah. Every time.
Every single time.
Because I remember we was there, we were Colin Bell level two, and it was like a full circle moment for my family, because in 99 we had the playoff final, we needed, you know, we were two down, going into stoppage time. I was 13. And I remember I was crying in my hand. I missed both goals because I was just like, consolation, Kevin Orlock. And then Dickoff scored. I saw him on his knees. And then obviously the rest is history. And then, you know, fast forward to this day. And Niles was my age. I was in 99. Aww. And we needed two goals again. And he was like a carbon copy. He was crying. Aww. And we looked the same. I think my dad was having a bit. Aww. I don't know whether he thought he was suffering from dementia. Now, but he's like, oh, God, is it 99? And but then everyone around him was like, just, no, listen, don't give up, keep the them. That's like City's motto now, isn't it? Mm. Whenever we think we're down, yeah, just turn around and that happened. Yeah. And I mean, my job outside of here is I do comedy. I had to take 2 weeks off. I literally couldn't speak because they're celebrating. Afterwards, we went to Didsbury with the Didsbury Blues. And, you know, I remember it was just carnage. Like, all the pubs were full, and to a point where people go into the co-op across the road. And all the alcohol, at one point, people just got Lambrini and they're spraying it at everyone. You know, the champagne had all gone. And it was just such a great moment. And so how did you guys watch it? How did you celebrate it?
Oh, yeah. I mean, as I say, goosebumps all over just thinking about it again. Well, I was working, doing my City Square job. And usually I do a post-match interview straight after. But this time, Hugh Ferris was going on the pitch to interview the players. I don't think they trusted me in case I just started, like,
Hugh.
going mad. Hugh. I love Hugh.
Not a City fan, are they?
I love Hugh. He's a professional sportsman, but he's certainly not a professional sportsman. Professional sports presenter. No, he's not a United fan. I don't know where those rumours come from. But he's an amazing guy and amazing presenter. So he went on to do it. So I got to stay in my seat because when I go down to the tunnel to do my post-match interviews, I have to leave my seat about 82 minutes. So sometimes I do, about 82 minutes exactly. So sometimes I do miss goals. But so this was good. So I was just sat in my seat this time. So.
I suppose what's the shame with that as well is I know when people leave the game early, we're all like, oh yeah. You don't remember the playoff final, but of course it's work.
I'm off to interview a player, yeah.
That was Jeff, so am I. Yeah.
So I was in my seat with one of my best friends, Emma, who's had a season ticket with me I've had mine for 16 years. Emma's had hers for about 12 now. So, and then my friend Chris, who sits on the other side of me, he sat in front of me when we had our season tickets at Main Road. So, you know what it's like at City? It's a little family. You know everybody around
you. You grow up together, don't you?
Yeah, you really do. Like, Chris has got two kids now, and you know, I knew him when he was like, you know, a little teenager.
Yeah.
So it's a little family all around. So, but yeah, when it was, you know, minutes to go, I'm a staunch 99er. I think sometimes people, you know, get sick of me talking about it, but I remember I said to my mum at 99, we're not leaving, we're going to clap them off. And that's how I felt in this game. I stood up and I shouted to everybody around me, we can still do this, come on, we can still do this. And then all I did after the game in the stands was just cry. Mum was like, pull yourself together. And then I had to go out and work because we do post-match City Square. So we went round onto City Square, and to be fair, it was so unprofessional, but it was what people were feeling. We were just bouncing around the stage, hugging, screaming, cheering. And then my memory from that moment is just turning around and there is this man on stage bounding towards me. I'm like, who's that? Bloody Andy Morrison's just run on stage, uninvited, run over to me, pick me up, and he's spinning me around. I'm going, Andy Morrison, we won the league! So... That
That's
was
not a bad way to celebrate the league, isn't it? City legend in Morrison.
Yeah. And then, in the hope that we'd won the league, I'd got asked to present the parade in the week running up to it. And so we went out that night. Yeah, just got asked to present the champions. You know, yeah,
you know, like you
as you do, normal oh, day. Yeah, no, yes. Well done, so it's called. Yeah.
She's going to start clanging yep. the names in a minute.
So I went out that night, celebrated as you do, thinking I won't get too hammered because I've got to present the Champions Parade the next day. Did my best anyway. Woke up on the Monday morning, shoes, coat, bag still over me, just lying on my bed. Just got in and just collapsed on my bed. I thought, oh my God, in 3 hours I'm presenting the Championship Parade. So jump in the shower, try and make myself presentable, get down to Albert Square, like try and sober up. And then it was single-handedly the greatest moment of my life. You know, I'm not married, I don't have kids, so I can easily say that. Best moment of my life, yeah. Standing on the stage and them saying, presenting your Championship Parade today is Natalie Pike. And then I just walked out and it was just the best moment of my life.
Thank you, Colin.
I felt like I was there.
Thank you. Life has peaked for me.
I actually was. I was only backstage though. They wouldn't let me on the main stage. So that's not quite like showing off. I was backstage watching my friend Natalie because we became best friends at one of the pre-season party, the first season party. We got free Heineken for the night.
Nice. And Colin and I bonded. Over
she's about to go back on stage to work, and I just showed up four bottles.
I was like, "Who's this guy that's carrying two bottles in each hand? I like him."
Yeah. And then one of us ended up topless outside the Midlands Hotel, and the other one was Natalie.
And I was shouting, "Go, Colin! Go, Colin!" And Colin was outside going.
Yeah, he doesn't take much encouragement. Yeah. Does he?
But it happened so quick because our Jason was driving us and he nipped in the hotel to get his stuff. So 1 minute we're all in the car and producer Stevenford is actually. He's knocking around the studio. Where is he?
That's a good story. I wound the windows down while Jason was out, turned the music full blast. It was some R&B tune. Went, go on, Colin. So Colin got around a lamppost topless.
Yeah. Nice.
That's what I do.
So yeah, that's slightly off topic.
A little bit, yeah.
So, a worthwhile story.
That's a couple of great celebrations. Yep. Mick?
Yeah, I was at home. No, I wasn't. I was at the game. But like you were saying about it being a family club, me and my brother had season tickets for years. But through twist of fate, we'd ended up separated. My season ticket was in the top tier. He was down in the south stand. So I got to my seat that day, full of excitement for we're going to win the league. Got there, aye, to everyone. I'm sat on my own. And I looked down to where he was and thought, I need to be down there. Aww. Now, the only problem was, I'm near the scoreboard up here, and he's down there, and between us are a few thousand QPR fans. So it's a long walk all the way around the ground because you have to go over the corporate. Anyway, I got there probably 2 minutes after kickoff. No seat there, so I just, with my considerable frame, bumped someone out of the way.
You'd assume there'd be a seat with us being the empty hand.
Well, exactly, yeah. Well, normally there was next to him, but yeah.
Big game.
Yeah, it was full. So I'd forced myself in. And obviously watching the game, you go through all the emotions. Zabaleta scored, we're winning the league, they got two.
Do you think Pablo's turned into
he's a forgotten man, isn't
he? Him and Jekyll are like Kevin Orlock, aren't they? Kevin Orlock's always like, can you just remind people, I scored in the play.
I was there. Mine counted. But yeah, so obviously watching the game, and it 2-1 going into it. And when Jekyll scored his header, I remember obviously jumping up cheering. And my brother was still sat down, and I was just punching him in the back, just going, we can do this, we're going to win, we can do it. And I just got, when that goal went in, I got that feeling, we are going to do this.
Yeah.
And then it's pretty much a blur, the goal going in, the tears, the being jealous that we couldn't get on the pitch because we were on the second tier. And then we did like pretty much every other fan there, left, went to the nearest offie, got some beers, went to town, and everybody just congregated in Manchester, and we were at the Vine pub just around the back of the town hall. And I actually had work the next day because I couldn't get the day off. Turned up 5-6 hours late, I think.
And you a driving instructor?
No, not my other job. My other job, Colin.
Wow.
But yeah, turned up 5 hours late, stinking a beer the next day, and then checked Facebook and somebody had shared an article off the Telegraph. And the main picture was all the City fans celebrating, and yours truly was at the front with beer in either angle.
Brilliant!
So yeah, we ended up back at Bredbury with Bredbury Blues dancing on tables till 3 in the morning.
That is a great night with the Bredbury Blues. We won't go into that.
We're never going home sober.
Oh my God, we did go Bredbury Blues one night.
I'm sure.
It's another night of drunken
pool table dancing and
yeah.
You never go home sober with Bradbury Blues.
No.
I think you've been on one of the trips I've been on before. Yeah. And they do get.
I love them.
Nick was the one smelling your hair behind you. moving on. It's time for a quick break. We're going for a quick break. But when we come back, we have got the ugly side of football where one of you gets a chance to win a trophy. We have Steve Rigby's guide to the Premier League. Get your cliches match report and yes. A little bit more. So see you in a few minutes.
This man owns a small business. He works hard in his business. He spends his days dealing with customers, suppliers, and general aggravation. He certainly doesn't want to spend his days dealing with the VAT man as well. After all that, you'll often find him at evenings and weekends working on his books. Or not. Sound familiar? With the high levels of compliance and the severe penalties for getting it wrong, wouldn't it be better if someone else could find any problems before the taxman does? You've got better things to do with your time than worry about your books. Think of all the other things you could be doing instead of crunching numbers. Just put all your paperwork into a box and let Accounts Direct take care of everything. Bookkeeping, management, accounts, tax returns, VAT returns, payroll, and more. Accounts Direct. Accountants on your side.
Welcome back to these charming fans. Still with me is Mick and Natalie. Pikey!
You say still with Pikey. Me like it's a surprise.
Yeah. New football. That's your football name. Pikey. Right. Mickey.
I think we should get Natalie to sign the duck. That way you can't give it to every guest every week and have it named
what
after
what makes
him.
You think I'm going to give it to every day?
Just a hunch.
Were you going to give that to every guest?
What happened to the pilot? Stayed in the pilot, Mick, okay? Archie was a great guest.
Get the Sharpie.
I kiss it.
Oh.
Right, there you go.
There we go. Pikey the duck.
Archie's going to come back.
Will it? Yeah.
I'm just not going to stand for that. So we're going to move on to a brand new segment. It's all brand new because it's episode one.
Yeah.
So it is all new. But this is going to be, I'm excited about this. This is called The Ugly Side of Football, guys. As you can see, there it is. Our mate Phil Jones. So The Ugly Side of Football is, so each one of us will take it in turns to nominate a clip that highlights the ugly side of the beautiful game. And the winner will get this beautiful trophy. I don't know if we can see it on camera, which has got Phil Jones's face right in there, and you get this. Look at your trophy. I got it today. £11. So
it's a trophy to lose, to be honest, isn't it?
I don't know. Don't hit the player.
It's a burglar alarm, isn't it?
Don't hit the player. Change the game. That's all I'm going to say. So the idea, it has to be City related. The clips have to be City related. So we have briefed you all. We've all brought a clip in. I'm going to kick things off. My nomination for this one is quite a few years ago now. We had a horrible little player called Ben Thatcher who thought it was perfectly okay to drop an elbow into Mendes's face against Portsmouth. So the guy was unconscious by the time he hit the floor. So I think we've got a little clip of that if you want to have a quick peek.
I'll tell you what, the elbow was raised.
Not
he didn't just block Pedro Mendes, he raised his arm into the side of the Portuguese player's face.
Probably
was that him, wasn't it? Look, he's out. The guy is out.
For Wimbledon against Sunderland.
Disgusting. And do you know what, though? Something that before we do your videos quickly, it's weird to say something was highlighted from that, but what it did highlight was City fans kind of went, that's not what we do.
Yeah.
And you've seen it in the past with United, and I didn't want to talk about this, but the Haaland incident with Roy Keane, United fans to this day laugh about that. They back Keane up 110%, whereas when that happened, every City fan I knew kind of went, we don't want players like that, let's get rid of him, terminate his contract and stuff. So out of something so horrible, I think that was kind of nice. City fans kind of just, we are like that.
Yeah, we've never been the club to have dirty players. No. We just don't have them, and that's why that was so shocking.
Danny Mills, Joey Barton.
I've got a great Ben Thatcher story you just reminded me of. Back in the day when I used to model and I was out in Manchester, he was in a club and he knocked past and he knocked my drink over and my drink went all over me. I went, "Oi, Ben Thatcher, you've just knocked my drink over." Got a wad of money out, chucked it at me and went buy another one.
Every cloud.
Humble.
I was like, "Take your bloody money, get lost."
Did you?
Ben Thatcher, yeah.
Did you take the money?
No, did he? Yeah. Taking Ben Thatcher's dirty money.
How much did he write you?
I don't know, it was like £40, it wasn't a lot.
It wasn't a lot to eat. These bars, you get half for £40.
Yeah, I don't even got a drink for that.
I do pound a pint in Weatherspoons. Come on, I want it back. Okay, if it's flat, I'll take it. So let's go over to Mick.
Okay. So mine is going back to that fateful day we were talking about, the QPR game. I don't know why I pointed at the picture, because that's
I was like, what QPR game? But
going back to that game, there was one ugly incident in that game. One of our former players, funnily enough, Joey Barton, decided to take it upon himself to basically leather Sergio Aguero. I can't think of another word to use. There was a bit of argy-bargy going on, and...
No pun intended.
No pun intended whatsoever.
Hey, come on.
But Aguero. But you can see when you watch the video, I'm sure we'll have a clip in a minute on the video. Yeah. There's a foul being given, and all the players are kind of...
Well, the initial challenge was Tevez.
It was with Tevez, yeah. So Tevez is on the floor. Everybody's remonstrating with Barton. And when everyone's back turns, you kind of see him snarl, look for the nearest player and just deck him with his knee. He just takes him out with his knee.
And then he tried to headbutt company.
He was trying to fight every. He was like Scrappy Doo. Yeah. He was trying to scrap
then
everyone.
Then enter Super Mario just to calm things down a little bit.
Yeah, yeah.
All right, well, let's have a quick look at that one then. There it goes. Look, that was the initial. Yeah. That's what got him sent off. I'm vile. He was a vile, vile player.
Yeah.
I know he says in his books and stuff that he was tactical. He tried to take off some players with him, but is he that clever?
I think he thinks he is.
He definitely thinks he is.
He does a good French accent.
Yeah. on a par with Steve McLaren's Dutch, it's good.
Well, that's another close call.
Good one.
Natalie, it's all down to you. What's your...
Well, you text me saying, think about what you want your ugly side of football to be. And then we played Crystal Palace and it was clear what my ugly side of football was going to be. That dirty, rotten Dunn and his tackle on Aguero in that Palace game that injured him and put him out for the Juventus game and might well damn have cost us winning the bloody Champions League.
I hate him so much.
Unbelievable. But it was just, the tackle was just dirty. He knew what he was doing.
It was full intent.
It was totally meant to bring him down.
If you look at the challenge... straight for the knee.
Straight for the knee. If he was trying to just bring him down, you know, sometimes you'll take one for the team, you'll get a card because they're breaking. But not on that. He's swung his leg right at his knee. And he's just meant to bring him down. I think he wanted to injure him. And he did.
If he was trying to play the ball, he'd have slid.
Yeah, definitely. He was trying to play Aguero, he was.
His foot wouldn't have been in the air. It would have been going along the ground if he was trying to play the ball. So, yeah, you're right. He was clearly just trying to take him down.
Get away from my Sergio. That's what I'm saying. You know how much I feel about
you
Sergio.
You are very passionate to a point that you've called your dog Sir Sergio.
Yeah, I've got a new dog. He's a French bulldog. He's 12 weeks old.
We'll try we've got a picture of him.
Yeah, I'll give you a picture. I've got a picture of him in a city shirt. We owned him for 2 hours, and my boyfriend went, "Let's put him in this city shirt that he pulled off a teddy bear." And I was like, "Yeah."
I was so jealous because remember when I got my puppy, because Natalie works at the club. I was like, "Come on, did he do dog clothes and city shirt?" So I got a little hat and scarf for mine. But then I saw that picture and went, "She lied." She lied to me.
It came off a teddy bear. It was a polar bear teddy bear, so the arms are out like that, so it's perfect for a dog, except I've been overfeeding him. It don't fit him anymore. It was only 3 weeks ago.
Okay.
Yeah, but he's called Sir Sergio, named after him.
It's a great name.
Well, one of my cats is called Vincent. I can't tell you exactly what my dad came out with about it, because I'll tell you off camera, but my dad seems to think he's named after Vincent Company. Because he's company for the other cat. Aww. And for another reason as well.
Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah. Well, I should have really named my dog something serious. Right?
Yeah, you can't.
Mine's Theodore Tedward Tedderson III.
Oh, nice.
You're not a real safe fan, are you?
No, he's
a helpless. I've got my own city show. What's up with you? Address. Well, have you got Mick? Hey?
Taught you to drive.
Sorry, this is my defence mechanism.
I know.
When someone attacks me, I get into the go.
Pick on the ginger kid.
Well, have you done Mick? You haven't even got a city car freshener in your learner car, have you?
What colour's your car?
Black.
Mine's blue. Yours is city blue, I saw yours, but I tried to get mine blue. So
you wouldn't have a car if it weren't for me, Colin.
I failed 3 times under you, Mick. Different show. Yeah. And for that reason, Mick, you was going to win this, because I agree, because we won the league.
The day
we did, but
happened.
You know what? Your attitude stinks, Mick, so congratulations, Natalie. You win the first ever... Ugly Side of Football Award.
Thank you. I was going to kiss it, but God, no.
Yeah, you've got to take Phil Jones home now.
No, No, thank you.
And listen, here's what's exciting now, though, guys. While you're celebrating, we'll have a little moment where you can celebrate and have a good time with your trophy, because it's time to introduce Gael Cliche to the show. Gael Cliche, our very own match reporter. We sent him to Chelsea. Here's how he got on.
Yes, thank you, Colin. You join me here at the Etihad Stadium on a glorious afternoon of Premiership football. We have had a great, great season-defining game already, even though we are only two games in. It was the home side that got off on the front foot early doors, with the mercurial David Silva side-footing a glorious pass through to the little Argentine Sergio Aguero. The visitors' keeper was more than equal on this occasion, though, thwarting the little Argentine at first. The game carried on in this vein until about half an hour in, when Aguero once again shook off his marker and coolly slotted home past the keeper. The game almost turned sour not long after, when Diego Costa and Fernandinho had a clash of elbows, the Diego Costa rolling round on the floor, when really it was just six of one and half a dozen of the other. The second half started off where the first left off. Although the visitors did make a slight resurgence, they were never really at the races today. The home side captain powered a header in from a corner to put them 2-0 up just after the hour mark, and that was game, set and match, really. The champagne moment came 6 minutes later, when the wonderful Brazilian Fernandinho slammed home a finish from just outside the area. 3-0 to the home side, and Manuel Pellegrini's men have laid down a real marker in the title race.
Good one. Gail. Do you know what? I'm sure you were separated at birth, Mick, you and Gail.
I can't see it myself, Colin.
Are you not really?
No. I think you're just being gingerist. We don't all look alike.
All right, well, you say that. Famous gingers. Maybe that could be a segment on a show in the future. Famous city gingers. Has there been many?
Steve Lomas.
The man who was very happy when he scored goals.
Yeah. He loved scoring.
Yeah, he scored quite a lot.
Yeah.
Younger fans watching will know, no idea what's.
Maybe like Steve-o,
yeah. Yeah,
yeah. But ginger's a new colour, isn't it? It's City.
It is. Ginger's in.
It's all about gingers.
Should we elaborate on that?
Yeah.
Just is okay.
See, they get angry. What's wrong with
you? We don't get angry. We're loving people as ginger. Especially me, I'm fat. We're cuddly.
Yeah, you could be the ultimate happy man, aren't you?
Exactly. Don't get much happier than this. I like the honey monster in a city shirt.
he's not done much anything, has he? Anyways, you know what we'll do?
Give you a second to think of something?
No. We've got a segment coming up that I want to quickly talk about, because you know Steve Rigby, producer Steve, as his nickname is. He's got his own segment on the show. Because he's quite a well-educated man, so what I decided to do was send him to every single Premier League ground to educate us all. Because obviously, as City fans, we know City. So what we've done, he very cleverly called it Steve Rigby's Guide to the Premier League.
Clever.
So should we have a look at our first segment? This is Steve Rigby at the Emirates.
Yeah, thank you, Colin. This is Steve Rigby reporting from the magnificent Emirates Stadium. Just walking around, just picked up a fan here, this gentleman. He's been an Arsenal fan for a long time, I believe, sir.
Oh yeah, 20 years, mate. 20 years I've been supporting the Arsenal. I've been coming down here to Highbury. I've got to... It's the game. I loves it. Watching Tony Henry, watching from the
Steve.
Audience with everyone
Steve.
Else
mate,
kicking
mate,
the
mate,
balls.
Mate, no, mate.
Steve?
Mate. Yeah, yeah. What, Cole, what?
You're not really at the Emirates, are you, mate?
No, I'm not, mate. No.
You're at the Fletcher Moss in Didsbury with Dave, aren't you?
Yeah.
Just still get me tenner?
No!
One job I gave him.
Shocking.
You could even do
he was
that.
Always going to end up in the pub, wasn't he?
I haven't ever met Steve when he's drunk.
That's because he drinks from breakfast.
I'd say he spent the petrol money on booze, but he probably just drank the petrol.
Classic Steve Rigby banter. And he's not here to defend himself either.
Yeah,
so this is good. Well, next week he'll be going to Villa Park. that's if he does show up.
Good luck, Steve.
So we are coming towards the end of the show. It's been loads of fun. Thanks for coming. So before we do go, we've got we'll talk about the games coming up, the next couple of games for the next show. We've got Sunderland in the Cup, which I think happens before. Basically, it would already have happened by the time we go out. But yeah, let's talk about it anyway. It's in the League Cup. Has the League Cup got its credit back, do you reckon? Because I know for years it was disrespected by the top flight managers.
We won it.
Yeah. I think, you know, in recent years it definitely is. It's teams like United who are now rubbish. They used to be good, now they're terrible and they'll never be good again. They now suddenly chase it, don't they? It used to be a Mickey Mouse Cup and they put the kids out, but suddenly they're going for it, aren't they?
Yeah, absolutely.
And Liverpool, the whole, you know, the part of the boring teams, really, isn't it? But City, though, we treat it with a bit of respect, don't you think?
We always treat it with respect. Yeah. You know, I always say at City we treat all trophies with respect. You know, Thomas Cook Trophy, we respected that trophy. We won it, we went
it's
for it.
It's got its own chant, that trophy.
Right, we've won it four times, so. Yeah. Is it four times?
We invented it and lost it.
And then went back to get it next season.
So we respect the League Cup. No, I know.
We just appreciate it. It's back to that the old City syndrome.
It was all we won for years. Yeah. That was all we had.
I'm a bit gutted with the draw, to be honest, though, because the good thing about the League Cup is that there's a chance you might get to draw someone that you've not been before. Bloody hate Sunderland. Yeah. I actually hate Sunderland more than I hate Everton. It's a rubbish stadium. It's bloody freezing.
It's grim, it's miserable, and we get beat 1-0.
Yep.
Right, well, you guys are really looking at all the negatives of Sunderland. I want to say a lot of I big up Sunderland quite a bit, because when we did win the league, they did the Poznan, they celebrated, and they were giving it the big one. So, they are a boring, negative team. They're not a great banner. Yeah.
But they're having an awful start to the season as well, which means
they'll definitely come out tomorrow.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so predictions for that one?
I'd rather not.
No?
I'm going to go for a 3-0. For us.
And do you reckon the kids are gonna get a run out? Because obviously we've spent a lot in the academy.
I think some will. I don't think all will, but some will, maybe from the bench. But we will put a strong side out. And I'm going to go for our standard 3-0.
I'm going to go 2-0. I'm going to say the team's going to be pretty much the same as it was at the weekend. We might, there's more chance of us bringing the kids on. But I think at this point, when we've lost two games, and because we do respect this cup, I don't think we're going to put the kids out. I don't think we're going to risk it.
Do you not maybe in the actual gets a start, Garcia, there's talk about him coming in. Not, don't worry. not that Garcia. I just panicked myself when I went, oh, is he back?
Maybe one. I think at the maximum you might see one of the kids starting. Probably not, no.
Caballero
will come in. Yeah. I tell you who I'm super excited about. Have you seen much of Patrick Roberts yet?
I went down to the last weekend. Yeah. Stunning.
Absolutely. Did you go to the Juventus game? The Juventus Premier Youth game?
No, I was working.
I did go, He scored the most ridiculous goal. It was insane. He picked it up in our half, took it himself all the way down, scored. So it would be nice to see him.
Yeah. And so then the next league game, we've got Spurs away. I'm confused with that one, if I'm being honest, because Spurs, I don't know how I feel about them. Like, you know, some years you go, oh, they're really good and they'll probably crash the Champions League. And then last season they weren't on form. This season they've kind of had a stop start.
Yeah, it's a bit mixed, I think. I'm just channeling the 5-1 and Dzeko's four goals, and we'll channel that and then we'll do all right.
That was such a snide thing. I know it's off topic, but Dzeko to get dropped the week after that. Yeah. That's when you know your confidence is always going to get taken back. Yeah. You score four goals and then your manager goes, you're on the bench next week. Yeah. No confidence at all. I think it's going to be comfortable against Spurs.
Do you?
I think so, yeah. I think we're hurting. I think we're hurting. The West Ham result, you know, we dominated the game and got beat. Juventus, like you said, 70 minutes there, we dominated the game. I think we're hurting, and I think this City are the team that's going to come out and really just go for the jugular.
Go on, Cole.
We need to, we definitely need to. That's the City we all want to see.
People like Zabaleta to come back as well, who's very inspirational to the team.
Yeah, but to be fair, Sanya's been great this year.
Yes.
My favourite moment, Sanya, happened today. Actually, I went to buy the new City shirt, and someone just called him Barry. It was brilliant. Like, everyone's trying to pronounce his name and just using his surname. And I think it was a security guard at the city. Went, all right, Barry. It's not Barry. That's not his name.
I love the fact that he's cut his hair and got dead good.
You know, every time someone gets a haircut,
haircuts are in.
Haircuts, they make you amazing, don't they? Yeah. So maybe Navas. Boney.
Navas gets a skinhead all of a sudden.
He looks so scary with it, don't he? Well, lovely. So predictions, I think a comfortable win, maybe 3 or 4 against Spurs.
I don't share that much optimism, but I do think we'll win. I think it'd probably be a bit closer, maybe a 2-1, possibly 3-1.
Do we know if Vinny's back yet?
Not sure, to be honest.
Silver should be, because
you're asking the wrong person, Natalie.
I think if Vinny and Silver are back, then 4-1 maybe. If Vinny and Silver are not back, then maybe 2-0, 2-1.
We're more than capable of winning.
Yeah.
Okay, and then finally, before we do wrap things up, predictions for the season?
Winning.
Just the league, or for me, I'm always
them all. Yeah.
I'm always that person. I say clean sweep. I say League Cup, FA Cup, Champions League, Premier League. Then next season, you know, the Community Shield and the Super Cup, and then the World Club Championships, because we've won the Champions League. Let's do it. Why not? I do it on Champions League.
If that doesn't
manager.
Happen, Niall's going to be so angry. Yeah. He's going to call everybody.
Pellegrini's terrible.
We do win the quadruple.
He's got plan A. He only ever wins trophies. What's wrong with him?
I think we'll win the league. I think we'll do it with 2 or 3 games to go this year, and I think I'm going for semis in the Champions League.
I'm very immature. I just nearly laughed when you said semis. Sorry about that.
Yeah, we'll win the league, and I'm going for semis for Colin.
He's got Steve Lomas on the brain, hasn't he?
Semi will always be winning. It's amazing.
Well, funnily enough, that was exactly what I predicted last time we spoke, was the league and quarters or semis in the Champs League. The domestic cups, I'm not so sure about. Not that we will disrespect them, but I think if something has to fall by the wayside, it's going to be them.
Yeah.
I'd love to see us win them all, but whether that will happen.
It will happen, guys. Don't you worry about it.
Thanks a lot, Carl.
I've got this.
Mystic Carl.
Mystic Carl, I've got the job. That's the end of the show. It's been great. You guys have been lovely. Congratulations on Pikey the Duck and the Ugly Side of Football
Award. I'm proud.
Yeah, Mick, you're going to be here next week anyway, aren't you?
So you're one week win I might trip. Win.
You never know.
I kind of get the impression there's a recurring theme, but I might win.
What are you trying to say?
Nothing.
Come on, it's not fixed. Well, that's it. We are at the
you're
end of
the
show. Come on, Ginge. You can do it. It's all right. Well, thanks for watching, these charming fans. Like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, and we'll see you next week. Good night.
Bye.